You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. And you know what? I've got a little bit of a glow about myself because I was told that I've been considered professional before this episode, before I hit record here. So I'm going to be giddy for the next hour. On this show, I have got a guest that has been just coming to Scotland and showing off and showing up. And I don't know, I'm still giddy from the professionalism comment beforehand. Let's forget about that for a moment. I'm joined by the Peacock, one of the outstanding talents coming out of Ireland right now. It's CJ West. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. That was a very professional introduction, if I do say so.
Oh God. I don't think I'll be able to cope with all these compliments. But yeah, thank you for coming on. I'm excited to have you on because you're a guy that I've been introduced to through Community Pro Wrestling primarily. That's how I saw the name CJ West, first of all. And then I do a little bit of research, cage match. And I find out that, yeah, there's some matches I'm definitely going to be wanting to speak about with yourself and talking about your wrestling journey, as the cliche goes. So I'm excited for this. I hope you are too.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. Any questions you have, fire away.
Yeah, so we'll start with the cliche. We'll get the icebreaker out of the way, the boring one. The questions coming from this one. How did you get to pro wrestling? How did you become a fan of professional wrestling?
Pro wrestling was actually banned in my house when I was growing up. My parents didn't like the violence, but it was like, when I was growing up, like I'm 32 years old now. So like I was attitude era was when I got into wrestling. And I mean, anyone around my age who was a lad was interested in wrestling. So my parents could try and like avoid it, you know, all they want, but I was surrounded by it. Going to school, I'd be there. All my friends would be, I'd go to my friends' houses. They'd have the recordings of Raw from the night before. And like, yeah, I think I was 6 years old when I first got into it, and it was actually Shawn Michaels took my interests like early on. I was drawn to him, just his charisma. So I think around 98, 97 thereabouts is when I first got into it. So yeah, long time ago.
I also thought you were like mid-20s.
Oh, like, thank you. Like I get that a lot until people see my bald spot.
I shaved my head just to kind of stop that comparison because yeah, mine was horrific. But we came in around about the same time then. I'm 34, so I came in just a little bit after you. It was 98, I think 98, 99 when I started getting into the old wrestling thing, and it was the same. It wasn't so much banned in the house. It was more a case of we didn't have the facility to watch it.
Yeah.
So it would be going to over to a friend's house and catching what I could, where I could.
But we didn't have, in Ireland it was on, you had to have, I'm assuming it was the same in the UK, you had to have like Sky Sports. And if you didn't have Sky Sports, you couldn't watch it. But we had Sky One, and we had Channel 4. And they would show, Channel 4 would show like an abridged version of like Raw and SmackDown from the previous week. When SmackDown started up, obviously it was on then because I think SmackDown started what, 99 or thereabouts. But like there was also like Heat and Afterburn were always on very early on and Velocity as well were always on very early on a Saturday and a Sunday morning on Sky One. And I mean like they were on like 5 or 6 in the morning. So what I used to do is like I'd set my alarm, I'd sneak up out of bed, I'd watch Heat and Afterburn, and I'd sneak back into my bed before my parents realized I was up. And like I'd be watching the telly on like one volume so they wouldn't know I was watching wrestling. And then yeah, I've just been fascinated from an early age.
It's incredible. Again, I did the same 6 p.m. I think after The Simpsons, Channel 4 was Heat. I remember that, and then I'd have to run home from Sunday school because I wanted to watch Metal on Sky One, and it was just all digital is what I had, all digital, ITV digital, all that good stuff where you could get Sky, and man, it. Kids have it easy these days. That's all I'm saying. I don't want to be old man yells at a cloud here, but or at the cloud, you know. Yeah, nowadays with modern technology, but yeah, we had to work to watch our wrestling, and nowadays like I could type anything and I could just watch wrestling all I want. So who are your favourites then? You said Shawn Michaels caught your eye initially, which is no surprise when you see kind of CJ West with the colour and the kind of pomp and circumstance that comes with it, the Shawn Michaels-ism on that kind of gear. Maybe not so much 98, 97, that was a bit more of a batch data style, but yeah, who else was kind of your guys or girls, I suppose?
Well, for me, I always say my favorite wrestler of all time, now it was Michaels for years, but it's changed, and like my favorite wrestler of all time is The Miz, because I just think he's the ideal wrestler. Like, he's perfect, he's versatile, and he can be put anywhere on the card, and he's going to deliver. So like, he's also someone who, when you look at the adversity he's gone through, I think he's a guy who, he never let his doubters affect him, and he just kept working hard and, you know, put his nose to the grindstone. And, you know, the guy's main event at WrestleMania, he's a two-time Grand Slam champion. I think statistically, in terms of like, if you take that as a statistic, he is the best wrestler of all time because he's the only two-time Grand Slam champion. And then like outside of Miz, obviously I have a lot of love for Shawn Michaels. Tetsuya Naito in New Japan is, when I got a bit older, I started, you know, spreading further afield. Like, I was a big Ring of Honor guy back in the mid-2000s. Like, I did a lot of tape trading, swapping DVDs around with different people, and like got really into Ring of Honor. But then like that led me to New Japan, and then became a big Tetsuya Naito fan through New Japan. And then like, if you're going back more classic, I have a lot of love for Macho Man Randy Savage, which you can kind of see with the ring gear that I wear, and like Dragon Steamboat as well. They kind of be like my five top guys, to be honest.
It's how did you get to tape trading? Because I never did. I had a friend who taped the pay per views. That was about as far as my tape trading went. But I lived in the sticks in like Rothes in Murray, which is nowhere. So yeah, how did you get into that?
So part of where it came about is like, I used to get like PWI and like Wrestling Observer and different magazines, that like print magazines, and some of the magazines would have like a wanted section for tapes that people would be saying, and you'd get in touch with them, and they'd say, oh, I can offer you this tape to trade, and you'd email them, or you'd you know, some people you'd have to write letters to wait till the letter came back because they just didn't have email. And then you'd post off the DVD, and then you'd hope you'd get, or the videotape, and you'd hope you get something back. And to be honest, every time I did it, I never had incidents where I didn't get it back. One of my friends, he had it happen more than once where, you know, he'd send something off and he never got anything back. And, you know, he'd obviously be disheartened about that. But like a lot of how I watched wrestling was because I had an old VCR player in my bedroom, and because I couldn't be downstairs watching it live on TV in front of my parents, I'd be up in my bedroom watching it there, on like listening to make sure no one's coming up the stairs and like, getting ready to press eject. Because it wasn't until I remember it being a big ordeal when I was like a teenager. I was like 13 or 14. I just said to my parents, you know, like, this is stupid. Look, I've been watching wrestling for years. And they're just like, they didn't approve it. It's like, oh, whatever, we don't really care that much. So maybe I could have avoided that if I said it years ago. But yeah, like, it's just, it's funny when I talk to guys who were in the same boat as me. Like, obviously they're a lot of the older generation, but like in terms of tape trading, like, there's very few people on the actual wrestling scene nowadays who seem to have done it. But it's always like, you get some good stories out of it when you're talking tape trading with people.
It's fascinating, but yeah, never something that happened where I was, but maybe it did. Maybe I was missing out the whole scene. Maybe I was too straight laced, and because technically it's piracy, you know. We don't want, no one discusses it, but it's piracy. That's what it was.
I can neither confirm nor deny that was a true story.
That's fine. Statue of limitations, I'm sure. But yeah, now, again, don't want to go back into the old man shouts at cloud. But yeah, nowadays, you don't need to, really. I mean, everything's kind of $4.99 away from being able to watch anything you want, kind of thing, when it comes to wrestling, which is, I suppose, it's fantastic for anyone who wants to learn about professional wrestling nowadays. They could just go type into Google. I don't know if there's a cooler search engine now, but Google Randy Savage, and they can find all sorts of tapes and videos and anything they want. And back in the oldie day, you didn't have to. You had to work for it again. But that's my bitterness aside, because I'm old. And I'm older than you, so I can say that without feeling judged. Get into wrestling, though. So were you able to go to see, you had to hide your love of wrestling from your parents. So how did you get into watching it live, as in going to shows in cities near you when it came to town? What was the kind of
because I had a lot of friends my age, I was like beneficial that I could kind of like, there was always, I lived very close to a venue called the National Basketball Arena in Dublin, which is like, it's a big venue. Over Top Wrestling, I've run there a few times. But Irish Whip Wrestling was the big promotion back in the day. And that would have been where like Drew and Sheamus and like Pac, these guys would have been regulars there. So you would have seen them. Jody Fleisch, when I was growing up, he was my favorite guy in the indies because he was just so amazing to see back then. Like, it was like, I always, when I'm talking, I sound like proper old when I'm talking to the guys, but it was like the him and Johnny Storm or the Ricochet and Osprey of their time nearly. And it was just going to see those guys. I'd go with my friends, and then I'd be out like, oh, I'm going over to, you know, John's house. I'll be back like in a few hours. And back then we didn't have mobile phones, so if I said I was in John's house, I was in John's house, you know. And then come back around, parents would be none the wiser, and they'd be like, oh, how was John's? Oh yeah, good, we played some football. And I would have been at a wrestling show for like 2 hours.
Amazing. But yeah, you mentioned Jody Fleisch. I haven't had the pleasure to see Jody wrestle live, but you mentioned Jody Storm, and I only got to see Jody Storm wrestle live for the first time last year. And when I got to see him, I was like, he's still cool. Like, this is the guy that I knew through the wrestling channel and the advertisements. So like, Jody Storm's here is the main attraction, the video, the little music videos they played during it. And to see him wrestle live, I was like, yeah, this was kind of worth the wait. He was still just as good, just as cool, just had that aura about him.
That's really nice to hear. Like, I love, you know, hearing that kind of stuff where, you know, like, someone lives up to the expectations that you have of them from years ago. Like, that's fantastic.
Oh man, I mean, the match also included Luke Sharp and Joey Legend, so it was on to a winner regardless.
Yeah, yeah.
To have Jody Storm in there, it was just an absolute icing on the cake. Do you remember? So you mentioned Jody Fleisch then, Jody Storm. Do you remember who was on your first proper card then, or is that too long ago to
honestly it kind of like it all turns into a blur for me when I think back, because there was another venue back in Dublin back in the day called the SFX that like it's gone now, it's gone years, like it could be gone coming up on 20 years at this point, but like there was all kinds of mad matches that were happening. Like, they had a AJ Styles versus Christopher Daniels in it and things like that. And you know, like the old Irish Whip shows back in the day are insane. Because you get like random matches. Like, there was like, I remember I was looking it up there last year, one of my friends, and there was like Drew McIntyre against Taiji Ishimori, but like, this is like yellow pants Taiji Ishimori, not like nowhere near current Bullet Club Ishimori. And it's like, it's from like 20 odd years ago, and it's in the town in the middle of nowhere in Ireland. And like, we're looking at this going, I was like, nowadays, like, that would be like, you could have that on like, you know, Raw, and it wouldn't stand out a place. Like, it's insane to think that like these guys have been there. It was also a bit random that they had like Ishimori, who's like a Japanese guy in some middle of nowhere town in Ireland. Like, it's just, yeah, there's a lot of stuff that just, it all turns into a blur when I think back that far, you know.
It just doesn't make sense, does it, sometimes when you think about that far back? Yeah. I think I mentioned it on the podcast before, but I saw Ricochet wrestle in Inverness.
Yeah,
he wrestled Chris Travis in Inverness at the Iron Works, and when I go back, I did a little bit of work with Rock and Wrestle, and I met him, and he came up to me and went, "Oh, hi, I'm Trevor." I'm looking at him going, "No, you're not. You're Ricochet. Don't you? Don't be silly." But no, it's amazing that people could go to these shows, good shows like Community Pro, OTT be a perfect example, because they get some fantastic talent and have some fantastic talent coming through as well, that you could be seeing the next. Guy on WWE, next girl on WWE, AEW, New Japan. It's why I keep imploring people to go to live shows. I mean, watching on TV, fantastic. Sometimes it's all you can do, because I'm up in the Northeast. I can't really afford to go down to Glasgow and regularly and see these shows, but just get to a show and who knows who you're going to see. I mean, I've seen Jack Morris wrestling Bucky. That's mad. That shouldn't really be happening. And now he's in Noah and killing over there. So how did you kind of go from watching it to then, when did you consider doing it?
I was 16 years old and I went to Irish Whip Wrestling, but it didn't, like, it was really weird the way they did things in hindsight. Like, and I always talk about it now, like with the guys, like, and I say how strange it was. Like, Sheamus had left at this point, you know, him and Drew were off signed by WWE, and there was different guys kind of taking charge of the situation. And what happened is they had this like tryout day where they had like three days in a row. It was a Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And I was in a hotel that wasn't, it was near enough to where I am. It was about like an hour away. But they did, like, there was a lot of people turn up on the first day, and they cut people on the first day. And then the second day, they cut people again. And the third day, they had like six of us. And they said to the six of us, you can come and train for us. But like they were asking like extortionate amounts of money, and you had to go and train in like this like back arse town in the middle of nowhere. And like, I looked up how to get there. I'm 16 years old. Keep in mind, like I'm getting around by my bicycle, and it's like, I would have had to get a bus. And then once I got off the bus, I would have had to cycle for 2 hours to get to where this was. And they were saying like they trained Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. And if you missed one of the sessions, you were cut. But like, it was an extortionate amount of money they wanted up front. And like, as I got older, and you know, I talked to guys who were involved, who are still around now and back then, they're saying, yeah, just it turned into like a bit of a mess in that regards. Like, it just, it wasn't what it was previously. Like, it was kind of living off the name value a bit still. And so it was when I was 24 and my, or it was 23 or 20, I think it was 24. But my grandmother was passing away, and I was in the hospital room with her. And she wasn't very coherent in her last few days. But she, the last proper conversation I had with her was, she was coming in and out of consciousness, was she said to me, she was like, she has a lot of regrets, and she's lying on her deathbed. And she said to me, is like, if there's something you want to do and you've always wanted to do, do me a favor and go and pursue it. So since I was, you know, 16, and I ended up not following the wrestling thing because I just got jaded and disillusioned by the whole situation in Ireland. I was like, well, this isn't something you can do in Ireland. But when that happened, I was like, okay, cool. I'm going to go and pursue this as a hobby. I had a friend who did it in Ireland a few years ago, just after we left school, and he moved to New Zealand, and he came back, and I met up with him because he was in between moving. He was going from New Zealand to Ireland to Canada, and he had to stay in Ireland for like 2 or 3 months. I met up with him, and he said, there's a guy who's just after coming back from WWE. He was in the NXT Performance Center, and he's taken coaching down at a place that was called Main Stage Wrestling. And that guy is Joe Cabray, who is the OTT promoter. So I went down, and the very first day I went down was actually a Jordan Devlin or JD McDonough and Paul Tracy seminar. And I just stood there and watched because I was too new to do anything. And then I came back on the Monday and I had my first class with Joe then. And yeah, I'm 8 years deep at this point. Here we are now.
It's amazing to think that it just took, I took one conversation from a loved one just to go, you know what, let's just do it, you know?
Yeah.
We mentioned, so are you jaded with just the idea of becoming a wrestler, or did that actually hamper your enjoyment of watching wrestling?
It kind of hampered my enjoyment from watching wrestling for a bit, because I just thought it was, the whole situation was very, like, I hate using the term, but it was carny and it was unprofessional, and it kind of turned me off wrestling in general. Like, I missed the whole Daniel Bryan run. I missed the whole, like, the Wyatts and the Shield stuff. I kind of came back in around the time the Shield split back up. I got interested again, but there was like a long gap where I was like, you know what, feck wrestling, I've no interest in that anymore. So like, yeah, like, I don't know, like, I think it kind of happens to a lot of people in wrestling at some point. They go and take a break, but they always come back. That seems to be the situation, and I was fortunate that that happened to me before I started wrestling.
It's the same even nowadays. Like, you'll meet people and you'll do it exactly the same, but they'll go, oh, I don't have to watch that wrestling, and then somehow, some way, they'll sidle up to you.
The big thing I found recently is like, a lot of my friends have gotten back into it because of the Cody Rhodes run leading into Mania, and like, they're texting me now and they're saying like, oh, did you see this on Raw this week? And I haven't even like watched Raw, and I'm just going like, I don't know what the hell you're talking about. Like, I haven't caught up today, but like, they're so on the money that they'll stay up and watch it now at this point. And these are guys who they haven't watched probably since like Ruthless Aggression, and all of a sudden they're really invested. The thing that I find is really cool, obviously being in my 30s now, a lot of my friends are getting into it again because their kids are into it. So when I'm doing shows, they're going to the shows with their kids and stuff like that. And like, it's even like, I've had a few requests from friends to go around to their house in my wrestling gear and things like that. So like, it is kind of nice in that aspect of things. But like, it's really, for me, I like seeing this rejuvenation of wrestling happening in the last like year or two. And I think it's only going to boom again when WWE goes to Netflix. It's phenomenal to see, because for a while there, it felt like, you know, people just weren't that interested in wrestling anymore. But like, you can see now they're always doing like tremendous in terms of ticket sales and everything else week on week. So
that's it. I mean, I took my 2-year-old to his first wrestling show last month, and he's just turned 2, so he's still a little bit too young to understand.
Yeah.
But right at the end, last match was Kilo Valhalla, wasn't it? And he was doing his old skull thing.
Oh, yeah.
And I just had him in my arms. He just went, skull! I went, yes, I have got you. I have. You don't understand, but I have reeled you into this. Next year, I'll take every show. it's fantastic. And I suppose as a wrestler itself, to see these people kind of light up, and young and old, getting into the wrestling, is getting into what you're doing as well, that must just make it all kind of worthwhile at the same time.
Oh, for sure. Like, obviously I'm good friends with like Ravy Davey, and I remember there was a guy, they call him CJ East over in like the Glasgow School of Wrestling, but he's a little guy, and he came to what was the show? I think it was it Thorn? That's a place. Anyway, the main event was me against Thatcher Wright, and after the show, he turned up at the school like the following week, but he was dressed head to toe as me. And his parents were saying that like he's never watched WWE, he's never seen anything, he's only seen that one show. And like just from that, like he was like, oh, CJ West is my favorite wrestler. And like so when I came over again, you know, I was down a bit earlier, I came to the kids' classes that was on, and like his face lit up when he see me. I called him CJ East, so he's CJ East and I'm CJ West now. And like even still when I go to the shows and I see him there, he's still dressed as me. And like that's for me is like I remember like the most recent time I was over there was for the WeeLC, and like I came out and I could see like 5 or 6 kids who are, you know, wearing the headband, wearing the t-shirt, and like one or two of them had tried to make like their own arm pastels and things like that. And I was like, that's pretty cool to see that effect that you're having on people, and like, and their faces light up when they see it as well. Like, it's an amazing feeling, to be honest.
We will definitely get onto WeeLC, but we'll continue our little journey through the life of CJ West. So you started training a couple of years later. You made a debut. Again, I'm basing all my information on matches on Cage Match. So that's probably incorrect.
My Cage Match is very, very like,
they're
lacking
in hit or miss. Recently.
Yeah, like there's so much missing in there. Like I checked it not too long ago. It's like it's missing, I'd say, probably like 60-70% of my matches.
Okay, so this could be a very awkward timeline that we've got going on. So it's got 2017 as your debut at the Hangar in Dublin. But so what was it like learning to train and then finally getting told you're making your debut?
Okay, so I'm going to, in case Cage Match is wrong, I'm going to clear things up. So my debut match is... It is 2017, August 2017, I think, is my debut. I was supposed to debut it was with Mainstage Wrestling was the company, and I was supposed to debut earlier that year in the May, but I had issues with my back at the time, so I had to take some time off, and then I came back and I debuted on the next show. But what happened was I was a cowboy. So for those who don't know, the CJ stands for Cowboy Jim. So my ring name was Cowboy Jim West. When I stopped being a cowboy, I was like, I can't just be Jim West. It kind of sounds like an accountant. So I was like, I don't want to be Jim West. So I was CJ West. I took the L boy and the M away, and that's why it's CJ now. But I did a cowboy gimmick. I came out to Wild Wild West by Will Smith, and I had practiced my entrance, I want to say like 100 times beforehand, because I was like, I always think like for me, it's like it comes back to the Shawn Michaels thing. It's like his entrance is a whole spectacle and things like that. And like I'm someone who believes in like a big entrance. Like every time I come out, I try and make my entrance as big as I can. Even then, like I had a whole dance routine that I did. And I remember like Foxy, who's kind of like, he's the senior referee in Ireland. I have the clips of it still, obviously I have the first match. So my first match is myself against Cody Knight, who was also known as Rick from Team Brick, which is a team he's stopped wrestling a few years ago, but it turned into a tag match then where it was myself and the Fabulous Nikki, who later became a tag team known as Ring Tex years down the line. And Callum Black was the other person who joined in. So Callum Black came out, issued an open challenge. I answered the open challenge. He laughed at me. He's like, I'm not fighting that cowboy. Like, but I just remember, as I was saying about Foxy hadn't seen me in the full getup until I came out. And when I came out, he just burst out in stitches laughing. I was doing this insane dance as well. You couldn't keep a straight face. And I remember like vividly to this day, because I had like their asses chaps, but obviously I'm wearing my tights underneath, and I'm trying to unzip them and they get jammed in my kick pad covers. And for me in that moment, like in your first match, everything feels so long. And that felt like 2 minutes. I'm going, oh my God, they're not coming off. And I end up like forcing them as hard as I can. And eventually they come off and I watch it back and it lasts about 3 seconds. But in there, I swear to God, that felt like 2 minutes. But anyway, yeah, match went well. I won the singles match by DQ, and then we won the tag match. And yeah, it was a nice little first match. You know, there's, when I watch back on it, it's one of those where you go, oh, I would have done this better than this, but it's like, you just have to take it for what it is. No one's first match is perfect. And you know, I had a lot of fun in it. So that's the main thing.
So with the cowboy thing, nowadays it's you, cowboys back, like the whole country revolution seems to be coming in the last year or two. Is there any chance of, a cowboy Jim West?
No. Not happening. No. The thing about cowboys is like, we actually had a seminar with like Walter or Gunter, and he was saying about like cowboy. It was really funny because we all joke about it at the time. He's like, no one ever gets over doing a cowboy gimmick these days. And then like a few years later, Hangman Page got ridiculously over at doing the cowboy gimmick. But he's kind of right in a sense, because every promotion, when you think about it, has a cowboy or a rock star, or like these are just kind of default gimmicks. And I knew even when I was doing the cowboy, I wasn't going to be doing this forever. It was just something that would kind of, I knew, would get me out of my shell and I could play around with it and have a bit of fun, like in terms of getting to develop my character side of things, and then I could switch it up down the line. And that was always the intention. I knew myself, I wasn't going to stay as a cowboy forever. So like, yeah, this is where I'm at now. I've gone from cowboy to somehow evolving into a peacock, and yeah.
But so when it came to like doing that, being outlandish, I suppose, you always been quite an outgoing person, quite happy just to for people to just not laugh but laugh at, all that kind of stuff. And
I have no problem talking to people. Like I consider myself very much an extroverted person. Like you know, like half the guys who come over from abroad end up staying in my house. You know, I get on well with the guys who come over. You know, like I've friends. I'm happy to say, like I was talking to Golden Boy Santos from Portugal. He was training WXW. He lives in Lisbon. But I was saying to him, I was like, if nothing else, the thing that I'm happy about in wrestling is, I'm happy to say I have friends, and not just friends, but good friends who I talk to on a daily basis around Europe. Like, you know, I've got like friends in Paris, I've got friends in Barcelona, I've got friends in Lisbon, I got friends in Scotland. You know, there's friends from all over, and it's like, it's nice to be able to, like, if I'm going to these cities, I can link up with whoever and just say hey and hang out with them for a bit. And you know, it's that for me is the thing I'm most grateful that wrestling has given me, is the amount of friends and like different experiences I've got to have with said friends as well.
When it came to your journey then, so you started in August then. Cage match this December, so that's their one strike for them.
What's it saying is my first match, out of curiosity?
It's a battle royal at Grappling and Cannes, white collar wrestling.
Oh, that's
David Keitel, Justy, Phil Boyd.
Yeah, that's like, that's probably like 10 matches in.
and the fantastically named Captain Sexy.
Oh yeah, Captain is a very good friend of mine. Like he's a very big international streamer now. Aaron the Loco is his name. He does like a lot of Call of Duty videos, but he started streaming during the pandemic. It's a funny story. I started streaming and he wasn't confident about doing it at first, and I pushed him to doing it, and now it's gotten to the point where it's his full-time job. Like he's a big deal in terms of streaming. Like he has millions of followers on YouTube and TikTok now, and it all just started from like streaming during COVID. Insane. Like
the COVID times was weird. Like people just did they made bread, they did online streaming, and or they did a podcast, and some people kept going.
Yeah,
myself. And was it the pandemic you said there, was that where you started doing it as well?
Yeah, or? So I started streaming in like the pandemic at the start, because I was bored. Like we were all just trapped inside, and it's like every day was the same routine for me. I get up, I'd work from home if it was a weekday, and then I'd go out. Like I was lucky enough, I had a home gym out in my back garden, so I was working out in the gym. And then once I was done, I had nothing to do, so I'd stream, and like sometimes I'd stream for like 20 hours at a time because I was just bored and I had nothing to do. But like true streaming, I built up a bit of a following. And like, to be fair, the guys who started supporting me, because everyone was in the same situation looking for stuff to do, and they're very loyal support even to this day, in terms of like they back me on the wrestling shows. You know, I know I can rely on them in terms of the crowds over in Ireland and things like that. They'll cheer for me. I make good friends through streaming as well. Like it's the weird thing. Like I'm good friends with a guy who's over in Boston. Makes no sense, but it was just like you start playing games with someone, you become good friends. Yeah, it's insane to think. But then like Captain Sexy and myself kind of went like foom foom in terms of swapping roles, because he I started off doing I did YouTube years ago. Like I think at my peak, I had like 12,000 subscribers just making video game content. But then he wanted to get into it, and I was pushing him to get into it. And then he was doing better than me in wrestling. And now it's kind of at the point where like he's doing fantastically in the, in terms of streaming. And I'm doing okay. I'm doing okay in wrestling.
just all right. But it's amazing to think that, yeah, that's, a lot of people find their niche. I mean, I'm absolutely opposite to you. I'm an introvert. If we met in real life, it would be a very awkward conversation, and I would regret every moment of it, because I know how awkward I am. But here, we can talk away. We can just talk about anything we want, and it's a bit more of a relaxed environment. And that was why I started it, because I needed people to speak to, because I love my wife. She loves me. But if we were in the house for 24 hours a day constantly, we probably would kill each other. So it was a case of just trying to find people to speak to. And then that's how podcasting came to be in this household anyway. And 300 episodes later, we finally got you on at some point. But before the pandemic, a couple of matches I wanted to pick up on. One being, the name I recognize being Sean Guinness, mm-hmm. who wrestled in Scotland quite a bit with Janie McDonough or Jordan Devlin,
yeah, as part of the
Big Hangovers. Was this one of your first proper, like, kind of very experienced names? And we'd have had like Luther Ward and the like beforehand, but when it came to a test, was Sean Guinness one of them?
So we had our own version of the camps, and it was called wrestling.ie, and I was fortunate enough to be one of the guys who, I wouldn't be on every single show, but like there was kind of like a B team, and I was on the B team when I was breaking in, and because of that I got reps against guys who are more experienced, like Paul Tracy and people like that. So I had experience wrestling some of the guys, but that was my first time wrestling on. So like, Sean is also one of my coaches and has been for years. So it was one of those where, I love him as a person. He's a great guy. Like he's a phenomenal wrestler as well. Like he's the guy I go to for my personal training, because I look at a guy who has been in shape and the shape that he is in for 20 odd years now, and I'm like, okay, he knows about wrestling, he's the guy you want to go to, and he's going to get you looking good. But yeah, that was, in terms of a test, that was a test, because it felt like that was one where I really had to step up and deliver. And the match went well. It was like I was doing the kind of thing at the time where I was getting closer and closer to the ring, and each time, like I got jumped the first time I went out, and then the second time I think I got a hand on the ring, and then I got beat up, and then I got in the ring, and then fucking someone beat me up again, and like the idea was it was building and building to me getting a little bit more in each time. But yeah, Sean, getting to work, Sean's one of my favorite people to work with, because he's so talented, and he just makes you feel at ease as well when you're wrestling him.
And the other match that popped up, which is actually post-pandemic, so years are all kind of merged into one, was Scotty Davis for OTT Contenders. Again, another very well-traveled wrestler as well. So, again, all these kind of matches, OTT, big shows, whether it's Contenders or their main kind of mainline shows, that's going to be one that's, again, another one that's going to be very testing for you as a wrestler, seeing how well you've come along in the last 4 years at that point, minus take one out for a pandemic. But was that another one that you kind of, you could mark your progress on when you're going up against someone
like that. For sure. I think in terms of like in-ring ability, like Scotty has the pedigree there. You know, he's multiple time European champion at junior level for Greco-Roman and freestyle wrestling. Like he's legit. That's the thing. He's also a guy like I've been training with for years. I know him very well. So to get in there with him, it's like we have two different styles as well in terms of wrestling. So it's always good. I think it's always good when you can have a clash of styles and see how you kind of hold up against someone, because like he's gonna eat most people up 9 times out of 10 in terms of like if you're trying to go hole for hole with him. Like he's a talented in ring performer. Like he's a very good wrestler. So like that for sure is like a good measuring stick to hold yourself against.
Right, let's get into Scotland then, because it's a Scottish wrestling podcast. I should really speak about Scottish wrestling at some point. You made a debut in 2021 against SBX, mm-hmm. the current CPW heavyweight champion. How did that come about? Was it through, because I know a lot of the guys from CPW came over to Ireland to do some of the training camps and what have you. Is that a relationship that struck up through there that led you over the sea?
So it was a situation where the guys from CPW who came over before the pandemic were SBX, Rave Davey, Thatcher Wright, and there's a fourth person and I'm omitting them and they're going to kill me for forgetting them. Who is it? I apologize. I can't remember. it's so long ago. But like a few of the guys from Scotland came over anyway. And it was OTT camps are kind of a thing that we've done annually now, sometimes, you know, twice a year. But it was the first one we did was a week long. Since then, they've been weekenders, but it was like Monday through to Sunday. So the guys were over all week, and every single night, it was like 8 hours of training a day. And then every single night we went out partying together afterwards. So through that, we became good friends. And it was like after the camp, excuse me, after the camp ended, I stayed in touch with some of the guys, like namely like SBX. I talked to like every day, if not every second day. Same with Ravy Davey, good friends with him. Davey gave me a heads up, he was starting a promotion and he wanted to try and get a few like imports in to try and like not just have guys from the local scene. Not that there's anything wrong with anyone in the local scene, but he wanted to have something a bit unique in terms of what he was putting on for a show there, maybe showcase some guys that they hadn't seen before. So the guys who were brought over for the first CPW show were myself, LJ Cleary, and Jay, aka Danny Cross. And the three of us went over to Glasgow then, and we wrestled on the CPW show. And Sam had been someone who, you know, I'd gotten close to. You know, he's one of my best friends even to this day. So it was a situation where when he found out we were coming over, Davey naturally put us in together, and you know, it was a lot of fun getting to be in there with him. So yeah, like that's pretty much the long and short of it. I just stayed in touch with the guys and the door opened pretty much.
It's the thing about what Ravy Davey's built is, you're right, you wanted to kind of bring in people that be different, because he's starting a promotion in Glasgow or the Glasgow area, which is kind of, there's a lot
saturated.
Of promotions. Yeah.
even like I remember having this discussion with people and they were describing the amount of like wrestling skills and promotions all within close proximity. And I was like, that is insanity to me. Like that's so many schools and so many promotions. But yeah, like no, what Davey's doing at the Glasgow School of Wrestling, like I've seen firsthand, I don't think it can be understated the amount of good he has done for his area. Even the getting to talk to the parents, you know, oftentimes what happens is with my flights, I'm on an early flight. So I'm there for early in the morning, I'll head down to the schools, see what's going on, and like talking to the parents, and they say like just the benefits that he has been a boon to the community. And it's, you know, like I know Davey, and like Davey is the perfect example I could give anyone of don't judge a book by his cover, because he has a heart of gold, and the amount of good he's doing for his community. And like his Davey would be the first to tell you he has main character syndrome, big main character syndrome. He has a podcast where he talks about how much his main character syndrome comes into play. But I think the happiest I've seen Davey is when his students start doing well. Like the guy gets moved to tears, and like genuinely, like when they get big moments, I think it means more to him, or maybe as much, I don't know, with Davey, you know, as much to him as his own big moments, because like he really wants to see these guys doing well. And like Caden Cross is a prime example of someone, you know, like I'm not going to go into Caden's story. That's his to tell, but you can look up all about it online. Caden has shared it. Davey has shared it. And like, that is what that Davey has done for Caden is very inspirational to me. And, you know, he is a prime example of someone who is changing people's lives for the better, whether people want to admit it or not, because I know that's a big thing. A lot of people go, it's only Davey. He is doing a tremendous world of good. And I think a lot of people from the outside looking in can see that.
Yeah, so it's certainly, he's a character, is Ravy Davey. For that reason, I think some people do like, he's one that can put his foot in it. But
yeah, for sure.
He's always with the best intention in mind. I think that's the best way to put it. He's always got the best intention in mind. For the wrong or right reasons. So how was your first kind of quote unquote international booking? Would I be right in thinking that?
That was correct, yeah.
So, and it's a Govan crowd, so it's an absolute mad crowd at the same time. Do you feel a difference between an Irish crowd and a Scottish crowd? I mean, it's a Govan.
I don't know, it's the Govan crowd as well, for sure. It's a different experience. Like, I always warn the guys coming over, because like I'm fortunate enough now that I'm one of the regulars in CPW, and I always warn the guys coming over for the first time. I'm like, this crowd's a bit different than what you're used to, because like, as I always remember the first show, the guys were like brawling around the outside, and I remember seeing kids come up and like just start like full on attacking. And I don't mean just like, you know, you do the spots in the shows here and you might get a slap or whatever. No, these kids were going like wanting to get tear flesh from the bone kind of thing on the heels. Like, I remember the heels, like the baby face got all crap and getting them back to the ring as quick as they could. But yeah, for sure. Like the Irish crowd in general though, like, yeah, we like the Tivoli crowd, the Tivoli's not around anymore, but the Tivoli crowd became like famous worldwide, where people wanted to come to all the independent wrestlers we're talking about. They want to come wrestle in the Tivoli Theatre. Ireland sports fans are insane. We always have been insane. You see it every time we qualify every 20 years for a major tournament for the football. Like, it carries over to wrestling as well. Like, all you have to do is watch one of the OTT shows and you'll see like the crowd are electric. It's a very different experience than what you get in terms of a Britwrest crowd. Like, we get lumped in with Britwrest a lot. We're not Britwrest. We're Irish wrestling. We're our own thing. The crowd here is electric, but it's like, it's a different type of electric in Govan, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, every time I've been to Govan, the crowd is insane, but it's a different type of insane that you get with the Irish fans.
On your subject of that, I'm calling out saying Scott Rez is also a third tertiary one as well, because every time I see a list of going Brit Rez stands out, I read it and go, not a single Scott in this list.
That's, I think you guys kind of suffer from being there. Well, it's just classic history there. The Scottish being overlooked by the English, isn't it?
Absolutely. That's why the Scots and Irish get all along so well together, because we're just all undermined by the English. This is a podcast. Let's move on. So before I get back into Scottish stuff, when I go through my list of matches here, one just caught my eye that I have to ask you about, and it's one from OTT, April 2022. You're in a tag team match against Session Moth Martina and Warhorse. Now, Warhorse, of course, a very infamous character in wrestling. He's no longer Warhorse, so he's go by something different now. But there was a moment, him and Danhausen just tearing up independent wrestling, and their Session Moth Martina, who of course is phenomenal. Is there more of pressure going to a match with two such highly known characters than a normal tag team match would be?
Well, this was my first match against an import. You have to keep in mind, like, Martina, she's a big name for sure, but she's also someone who I trained with for years. Like, she trains in the same training school as I do. She's one of the coaches. So like, she's someone I go to in terms of advice for character or entrance, because you look at her character and entrance and where she's gone with it. She's a great person to ask for that. So yes is the answer, but it's also, I felt comfortable because Martina is such a professional in there. Like, you know, she played up to the Warhorse gimmick. And at the time, this was myself and Fabulous Nikki. We were the ring technicians. We were basically a throwback 80s tag team together. So we came out to, like, we initially, initially came out to Motley Crue, and it was Take a Look on the Wild Side. I can't remember, or Take a Walk on the Wild Side, sorry. But neither of us were really feeling that, so we ended up changing it to Shot Through the Heart, which I now use in Scotland all the time. Yeah, for sure, like it was pressure, but it was also like a lot of fun, and it felt like had a lot of responsibility to live up to be put in that scenario where you're one of the guys. You know, there's not a lot of imports brought over every single show, so to be one of the guys selected to wrestle against the import was a big deal for me. And you know, it's a match I look back on fondly. I had a lot of fun in the match. I always have fun when I'm in the ring with both Nikki and Martina. And Martina is someone who more recently in the last year or two, we've actually had a lot of tag matches together on the same team. Just by coincidence, we keep getting put in tag matches together, but she's someone who I really enjoy working with. Like it's a load of fun every time she's out there.
I mean, you mentioned I Session Moth Martina and their character and someone who you'd definitely gravitate to for advice on that. I mean, on that same card was Scotty Hoy. That another guy that must be like, yeah, I need to try and pick something from this guy while he's here. I don't know if he probably did a seminar as well.
Yeah, like he did a seminar with us, but I asked him, he's quite good friends with Nikki, who was my tag partner at the time, because he's been coming over to Ireland for years, predating OTT. Like there's you'll have to look up your wrestling history here, but there's a promotion called American Wrestling Rampage, which Joe Cabray, who is the owner of OTT, ran years ago before he went off to WWE. And on those tours, he had like Scotty Too Hotty, he had Booker T, he had Scott Steiner and all these kind of guys. So Scotty Too Hotty had been friends with guys for years. So we went up and we asked him, would he watch our match? And he gave us the advice of, he was saying, I don't think you guys need to do as much in terms of your shine. He was like, look at maybe making your entrance bigger. And he's like, if you make your entrance so big, then you don't necessarily need to do a shine. And he's like, he was saying in terms of longevity, like if you can take, like if you're given 12 minutes and you can take 4 minutes of that up with an entrance. And like, if you look at his entrances these days, he's a guy who he makes the most of his entrance. And the fans are so electric by the end of his entrance. It doesn't really matter what happens in the wrestling because they're going to remember the entrance at the end of the match. When they think back on the show, they're going to go, oh, Scotty's entrance was amazing. So like I've taken that advice to heart. And like, you can see with like the Peacock character I've been doing lately, I've been trying to make the entrance grander and grander every time. And like, part of that is because of the advice that he's given.
He's not wrong at all. I mean, one of my favorite matches I've ever seen live was him versus Grado, 2014, Beach Ballroom, Aberdeen. And I could tell you nothing about what happened in that match. I couldn't even tell. I could barely tell you who won. But I know that in that moment, in that 10, 15 minutes, that it was the best thing I've ever seen because it was just...
Yeah, but that's two guys with phenomenal entrances when you think about it.
Exactly.
Like, yeah.
Probably, if I watched it back on DVD, there's probably about 3 minutes of actual content. The rest of it was just entrances and dancing, and I would have loved it. I probably still love it now, watching it back as well. But interestingly enough, mentioned Scotty Too Hotty was on that show. Another guy that was on that show, Eric Young, who you ended up getting in the ring with November 23 for CPW, I think it was, as well.
Yeah, that's correct, yep.
So it was the Govan team and CJ West taking on Casino Brutal and Eric Young. That is a phenomenal match in itself. When I read it was going to happen, I was like, yes, I like the sound of that. Getting in with Eric Young, though, someone who's done the kind of big outlandish things, gimmicks and what have you, and now he was at that point, I think it was just more of a I'm going to rip you apart kind of style. What was it like getting in with him?
So I have to give credit where it's due. Steg and Zander from the Govan team, they're phenomenal in-ring workers. You know, it's always a pleasure getting to be in there with them. Great guys as well outside of it. The thing I was really honored about is Davey was telling me when it came up that the match was going to happen, Davey couldn't be in it because he was in the storyline for the title, or he could have been the champion at the time. I don't remember the exact ins and outs, but it was a situation where the guys unanimously said, we want CJ West in there. So I felt honored when I heard that. Like it was unbelievable to hear that your peers think that highly of you, that they want you in the match. But then getting to work Eric Young himself, you know, phenomenal. Being in there with Casino Brutal as well. Like they're two guys who like I always enjoy wrestling. I think they're flying under the radar. Their promos are so funny. I just want to point out, like, anyone who's listening to this, go look at Casino Brutale's promos, because they always crack me up. Like they're flying under the radar in terms of acknowledgement. I just feel on the grander scale of things, they're a very good tag team, and their promos are entertaining, their matches are entertaining. But yeah, enough about those boys. I'll move on to Eric. Eric was, you know, he was phenomenal. He was a great sport. We went out the night before. He had a seminar. My flight got in just at the end of the seminar, so I kind of caught the last 15 minutes. And then we went round to a pub together. And he was saying, he was like, I don't know, guys. Like, I've never been booed. I've never been booed like anywhere I go. I was on TV for years. It's like, he's like, booking me as a heel doesn't necessarily work. And we kind of got into a thing, and we're like, it's different in Galvin, trust me. And he was like, no. And we're like, nah, you're not getting cheered, trust me. And he was like, nah, guys, just trust me, it's gonna happen. And then Xander said to him, was like, we're the Galvin team in Galvin, you're not getting cheered. And then he goes, okay, what about the other guy? And he goes, he's the most over fucker here. So fucking funny. But like, we all had a good laugh about it. Next, the Steg went to like put money on it, but then kind of backed out of it. And then when we came out, he got booed, and he comes to the back and he was like, you guys are right. And then Steg is like, I should have put money on it. It was a very, very like funny interaction between us all. But in terms of the actual wrestling, he was a gentleman. It was a pleasure getting to work him. He was really open for any suggestions that we had, and like you know, he was super chill and super cool, and his feedback was very good afterwards. Very, very nice individual. I can't speak highly enough about my experiences with him, because he was so nice.
I think if I remember rightly, you talk about Casino Brutale's promo. I think I'm in that one for that match particularly. It was the Guess Who board.
Oh yeah, that's a phenomenal promo, the Guess Who.
Yeah, I'm one of the squares in the Guess Who board, and I
when that's I your saw, claim to fame.
When I saw it open up, I was like, is that, that's me? Going, oh, it was amazing. But yeah, a team that I've highly, just anyone who asked me about best tag teams, I throw Casino Brutale in there, because they're incredible. Let's continue on the old Scottish tour here. What was it like getting to wrestle during Clash at the Castle weekend? That was part of Cease and Desist in a scramble match, I think it was.
Yeah, that match changed about 20 times what it was supposed to be, because there was just so many people around, and like I think like it went from being like, it was, I think it was initially I was told I was in like a singles, and then it got changed to a triple threat, and then it was a five-way, and then it ended up being like an eight-man scramble in the end. Like it's an experience. I think the previous time I was over, I was in a seven-man scramble, so I was like, oh, it's one extra, why not? But yeah, no, it's good fun. Like I always like getting to have a variety of match types and things like that, and getting to wrestle on that weekend. You know, there was a lot of people who are, you know, buzzing to just come and see any kind of wrestling before the wrestling. Everyone's in the mood for, they just want to see wrestling at that point. And even a few of my friends who are over for Clash came to the show, because they're like, oh, you're wrestling, we're going to be in Glasgow anyway, so we're going to go to the show. So, you know, it's pretty cool getting to see some of your friends from Dublin go over to the show and watch you wrestle. And then they come back to you and they go, oh, you're doing all right for yourself, you know?
Yeah, no, not bad. We need to go to Clash at the Castle. But yeah, I mean, what I'm hearing from that whole weekend was, it was just, yeah, madness. It was like, there was wrestling everywhere. There was people everywhere with wrestling merch and just being pumped for wrestling.
Yeah, I think one of the promotions did like a show after the show, which like apparently like ended at like 3 or 4 a.m., which I just thought was madness.
Yeah, ICW, I stayed up for it. I was like, oh, it's all right. I've watched the WWE pay-per-view. If I do that, I stay up until 3 anyway. I'm not built for this anymore. I'm not built for 3 o'clock in the morning.
I think it's a bit different when you're there physically, as opposed to sitting on your couch at home as well.
And I know, with my laptop on, because I can't figure out how to get Fight on or Triller on my TV, and I'm just like falling asleep. I mean, I enjoyed the show from what I saw. I think I fell asleep through two matches, but you know, that's because it was 3 o'clock in the morning, not for the show itself. Anyway, WeeLC. I think I've held off long enough. Let's talk about WeeLC 2. Officially, WeeLC 2, yourself, the Wanderer, the big strong man, the man himself, Swoggle, Hornswoggle, former WWE Cruiserweight Champion, Hornswoggle. I mean, you put out the challenge initially. That's how it happened on the shows. What? Just, yeah, how did that come to be? How was it?
So there's a story behind this where basically after that very, very first CPW show, I went up to Ravy Davey and I said, Davey, this ceiling is very low. Can I have a stepladder match in this venue? I didn't want a ladder match. I wanted a stepladder match. And he was like, yeah, we'll do it down the line. Like, and I was like, cool. And then it was kind of a running joke between us. And then it got to the point where he was like, oh, I have Hornswoggle. I'm going to do a WeeLC. And I said, Davey, you have to put the Irish guy in with the Irish guy. I was like, and especially if you're doing WeeLC, I want to be in there. And he was like, all right, cool. But he was like, I'm going to put Wanderer and Big Strong Man in there as well. And I was like, I'm completely on board because both those boys are like, they're great guys, great workers. And to be honest, like, that is the most fun I've ever had in a wrestling match. Like, the whole time you're in there, you're just kind of saying, you're snapping yourself back to reality and you're going, I'm in a like WeeLC match with Hornswoggle right now. And like, I'm beating the crap out of Big Strong Man with a tiny stepladder and throwing like a tiny chair at the Wanderer. Like it's the whole thing was just insane. And like, for me, the thing, like, that was the very first match I've had in like my 8 years of wrestling that I had after the match. Like, I put it up on my Instagram or whatever and like my socials. And then after the match, my friends, like some of whom I hadn't talked to in years, like, so like acquaintances, friends, you know, people I used to go to school with, all of them messaging me going, what the fuck are you doing wrestling Hornswoggle in Scotland in a tables, ladders and chairs match? And then like people just going like, it's so cool because it's like, as big as Eric Young is, like, everyone my age knows Hornswoggle. That's the truth. Like, he's such a unique performer that, like, and especially in Ireland, like, before we had Seamus pop into the scene, like, we had Finlay, who's from Belfast, so he's Northern Irish, and then we had Hornswoggle as our Irish representatives. So, like, everyone in Ireland knows Hornswoggle, who's a bit interested in wrestling. And, like, yeah, like, the whole... He was such a gentleman as well. Like, honestly, I know I keep saying this about everyone, but he was such a gent. He was really nice and like he was very complimentary to us afterwards. And he was good fun to spend. I was with him all weekend because, you know, he was there for the Anarchy at the Aki's like show the day after, and then APW we were on together. Like, yeah, he's a gentleman. And like, to be honest, to him, that match itself was probably one of the highlights, if not the highlight of my wrestling career so far, because I just remember being in there going, like, taking a second. And like, I remember I had a ladder and I was looking to the back of the venue and I could see LJ Cleary and the Freshness, who I'm good friends with, and the three of them, their faces were all just lit up watching the anarchy unfold in the ring. And for me, that was a thing where I was just going, like, what the hell am I doing? But like, this is so much fun at the same time. Like, yeah, it's carnage. I think it's on like somewhere. I think Davey has it up on Patreon or something. Go check out the Community Pro Wrestling page. I'm sure there's links there somewhere. But yeah, it's a really fun match. And I had a blast doing it.
I mean, for anything else, to see the Wanderer get choke slammed off a stage by Hornswoggle, I think that's possibly worth the price alone. Just
yeah. He got choked on off the stage. I got powerbombed through a table off of a stepladder.
But yeah, like, weird, isn't it?
wrestling is bonkers. That was the thing that got everyone, like, was I put up the clip of me going through the table and everyone's going like, why are you getting powerbombed by Hornswoggle through a table, you know?
And then you finished that weekend with the Dream Team, you and the VLs together.
That's Rocky Ross's dream match. Rocky Ross, for whatever reason, became super obsessed with CJ West, and all the lads were taking the piss out of him. So he loves the 80s Macho Man-esque CJ West, and he's not too keen on the new Peacock character. He was saying, like, he was like, oh no, go back to doing your own. But it's like, I feel like it's at the point where I've got to evolve, and you know, I got to spread my wings per se and go full on into the Peacock persona. So you'll be seeing the Peacock persona pretty soon over in Scotland as well.
Of course, yeah, we'll get to the questions on the old Instagram and that in a second. But yeah, you're back, Governversary, 16th of November, I've got noted here. Whether you're back before then, I don't know. I don't have it written down.
But I believe I'm over for APW in between, which is the 25th. Yeah, the 25th. I think 25th of October. And then I don't think I'm back until November for Gov Anniversary.
I did have a feeling you're going to be part of Rugby Havoc, but I didn't have a match announced for you just yet, but it will come, I'm sure, by the time this episode goes out.
I know what it is. I'm on the poster. I won't spoil it, but yeah.
No.
It's going to be fun.
we'll let the Wanderer get that information out. But you're taking on someone that you're very familiar with on that night for Gov Anniversary, taking on Renzo Rose, who you've faced before. Someone who is another one that's coming out of the Irish scene quite... Again, with huge, huge plaudits to go with them. So it's kind of like a home away from home kind of match for you and Renzo. Is that something that you feel that's the case, or how do you feel this match is for you as part of a CPW show?
I'm excited for it, to be honest, because Renzo is a phenomenal in-ring performer. Like he's a phenomenal performer in all aspects. His in-ring stuff. I've wrestled him a few times. You know, I've wrestled him for No Limits Wrestling. His very first OTT match is actually against myself and Fabulous Nikki. He was tagging with Sammy D, where Sammy D didn't tag him in at all in the match, and then super kicked all three of us at the end because he was being a bit of an arsehole. So I've tied up with Renzo a few times, a few different promotions, No Limit Wrestling as well, like Hard Knocks. Now we're getting to do it over in Scotland, so I'm looking forward to it. But I feel like for me, like Scotland and Glasgow and CPW has kind of become my home away from home. So it's one where I think he's going to have to bring his A game in order to be able to keep up with me. Whereas in Ireland, you know, he's definitely on a higher pedestal than me. I think the playing field's a lot more level over in Scotland, to be honest.
Fair enough. So before we get dive into the questions, you've wrestled in many countries now, Scotland, Spain as well, along with France, basically Paris just as a country, that's not correct, France. Is there any countries that you have your eye on coming up? Because I know that like the Scandinavian scene's still pretty hot right now. I mean, the French scene seems to be just going bananas at the moment. But is there any countries that you're wanting to bring the peacock to?
I'd love to get into... Belgium. There's a few promotions over in Belgium at the moment that are just really, really, they seem like they're heating up and piping hot. And obviously, like, you know, Germany, you know, I'm not going to rule out any country because, to be honest, everyone wants to wrestle everywhere. That's the truth of it. Like, yeah. I want to wrestle everywhere I can. I kind of got into wrestling with the goal of Liga Nova. Like, I was like, oh, if I get on the show, I'll be happy. And then once I got on the show, I was like, oh, well, I want to get on OTT. And then when I got on OTT, I was like, oh, well, I want to have a few matches, and I had a few matches, and I used to set really long-term goals for myself and like stuff like that, but I'm kind of very much, I go with the flow and I try and work as hard as I can on all aspects of wrestling. Like, so I train, I go to the gym, I work on my promos, I work on video editing, all that kind of stuff. Like I work on my social media stuff. I try and just improve everywhere. And then I'll kind of see what happens from, I'd love to go back to France again. Like, I wrestled in France back in January, and the crowd there are just, you've seen a backlash, like they're phenomenal. The French fans are phenomenal. So like, it's like Galvin, it's like Ireland. It's a different kind of electricity that they bring, but like they have their own chants that don't necessarily translate in English and things like that. But like, it's absolutely an electric scene. So I'd love to head over back to France. I guess if I'm picking somewhere to go back to, it's probably France. And then I don't know, like everywhere that will have me, to be honest.
I know, I found myself in 300 episodes, I've done this, over 300 now, that when I ask, there's two questions I really should stop asking. Where do you want to wrestle? Who do you want to wrestle? Because the answers are always the same. Everyone and everywhere.
Yeah. I think I'll give you a different answer. I seen Karen Noir came back, and I'd love to do the Black Swan against the Peacock. So that I seen he just came back there recently, and I was like, I think we're on polar opposites in terms of the poultry scale there. You know, I'm colorful and loud, and you know, he's noir, as they say, like black and white, and you know, he's silent, he's all about the art. My art is more abrasive and in your face. So I'd love to tie up with Karen Noir. He's definitely someone on my list.
If I want to throw out a suggestion to you, there's a guy, I don't know if you've heard, Retro Randy Valentine. He wrestles up in Fair City Wrestling in Dundee, Perth, Dundee, Angus area. He's got the kind of the old feather boat, the tassels and what have you.
Oh yeah,
I would love to. He's quite a bit older, so I would love to see kind of like some sort of like you in the future looking at yourself and kind of mirror doink going on. Just throwing it out there, Randy, if you're listening, John, if you're listening. I mean, Davey's going to be in end of September. He's going to be Ardlermania in Dundee. I mean, just tag along, we'll get a match going, get you and Randy in the ring.
Might do, you never know.
So onto the old Instagram. I've just bashed this question, but it's been reworded by Lily to make it sound way better. Anyone on the Scottish scene you've got your eye on to wrestle right now?
I really want to wrestle Ronan King in a singles match. We were supposed to have a singles match in, I can never remember all the venues. I want to say Helensburgh, but it's not Helensburgh. We were supposed to have a singles match earlier in the year, but when I flew to Barcelona to wrestle, I got a sinus infection. And going on the plane on the way back, it made it really, really bad to the point where I couldn't fly. I was told I couldn't fly. So I had to, first show I've ever pulled out of, but I had to pull out a show because I was in such a bad way that it wasn't possible for me to wrestle. So we never had our singles match. I've had a tag match with him and Judas against myself and Cian Noonan, who is, you know, he's very talented individual, really talented high flyer. He's had a few standout matches in Ireland against he's wrestled Robbie X on OTT and like Kuro, who's another standout from the French scene, and both very good matches. But myself and Keane, we did a thing a year or two back. I don't even remember. It's all blurring into one for me at this point, where we did, it was called Most Devastating Moves, and it kind of picked up a little bit of traction. It was just me hitting him moves, beating him up the whole time. But we kind of treated it like he was my young boy, quote unquote. We're actually from the same area, but there's an 11 year age gap between us or something like that. But he literally grew up like a minute walk from where my parents' house is. So we tag together. We call ourselves Green Hills Gang, but we have a running thing that every time when we tag together, we change the team name. So we have had like 7 or 8 different team names at this point.
Oh, I love that. I love that. That's the sort of stuff I like in wrestling. Just the absolute absurdity to it. So Ronan. Yeah, Ronan King. That's going to be a popular answer for Lily. Me as well. I love Ronan. He wrestles up in the Northeast here. So
like, in terms of like Scottish lads, like it's, I love wrestling. I love wrestling over there. And there's a few guys who I haven't had the opportunity to wrestle who I'd love to. Like Aspen's another one who, you know, I've wrestled Aspen in a scramble, but it's not quite the same as a singles. Caleb, another guy as well. But it's the same kind of thing as when you're both faces, it's hard to get a reason for you to be in the conflict with each other. There's a number of guys who I've never had a singles with Davey either. Like, or Xander, like I'd love to wrestle those guys as well. But once again, it comes back to the whole, do you know, if I'm going with a realistic one, I'd love to wrestle Wanderer in a singles because I've never wrestled Wanderer in a singles. And I know he's turned his back on the fans as of late. So it would be great to tie it up with Mikey.
There you go. And Lily's also asked, what is it like tagging with, what was it like? That's me. I can't read. What was it like tagging with Stan in Rugby Mania?
Oh, Stan is such a great lad. I have nothing but nice words to say about Stan. And like, it's funny, like we realized we looked like brothers because we were tearing down the ring after one of the shows and we were both wearing like a red hat and a black jacket. And someone went to him, went, oh, CJ. And he turned around, it was him. And then like a few minutes later, someone went, oh, it's Stan. And I turned around and it was me. And like, we both laughed our heads off because the same thing happened. Like it wasn't a joke. But yeah, he's such a good guy. And like, it was so much fun. Like, we were texting in the week leading up saying like, cause he wore my ring gear for the show as well, because we knew we looked similar. I texted him like the night before. I was like, what way is your facial hair? So I shaved my facial hair exactly how his was as well, because we wanted to look as similar as possible. And like, it's almost so much fun tagging with Stan. Like he's a great guy. And like, yeah, I have nothing but nice words to say about him.
Love him. I love Stan. He's so creative as well. When it comes to like, he's got encyclopedic. I've watched too many times. Encyclopedic knowledge on like movies and stuff like that. He's a fascinating soul to dig deep in, speak to. He's great. And the final question that we got from Lily is, biggest wrestling inspiration?
Biggest wrestling inspiration, I guess, is probably The Miz. Like I said, you know, he's someone who I think when it comes to, like, I always pride myself on my work ethic, and he's someone when it comes to work ethic, he is the, you know, the top of the mountain. Like, he's someone who you can't match. He wasn't genetically gifted per se, or like, he's not like, he wasn't a hulking behemoth, but he still managed to accomplish everything that he's accomplished just through sheer will of his own force.
And before I get to the last question, I've just got to ask, is wrestling the Kings of the North as terrifying as I think it is?
Yes. Thank you. You have to keep in mind, like, Corbin has, like, I don't know, like 40 kilos on me as well. So, like, both the lads have like 40, 50 kilos. I mean, they're proper heavyweights compared to, I'm a featherweight. So,
yeah, I saw that match. I was scrolling through. I was like, oh, that sounds terrifying. And then you had Corbin on just one on one. So you couldn't actually just like batter whoever you were tagging with, which I assume was Fabulous Nikki at the time. But yeah, you can at least kind of move him that way. Last question we got is from Ainsworth 6410. Would you ever do a death match?
No, no interest. I don't. For me, it's not something that, like, I don't have an interest in. It's not where the great thing about wrestling is, it's like an art form, and there's different types of art form to suit different people. I don't see a reason for the character of CJ West to be in a death match. Like, that's the truth of it. Like, when I think about it, it's like, my character is, you know, I'm super clean cut and all the rest of it. So why would I, like, the evolution of my character has been, like, in OTT, I started out as the ring technician. Like, I was the guy who put up the ring. So because I put up the ring, I'd try and stay in the ring because, you know, I've put all the effort into it. It's like, I kind of carried that forward. I try and keep the consistency in terms of the principles that CJ West, the character, would have going forward, and I just don't see a scenario where I'd be doing death matches, to be honest.
We'll stick with WeeLC, and
WeeLC hurts enough as is, trust me.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. Let's plug your stuff, plug Twitch, plug everything you can plug. Outlets are open.
Okay, so I'm on Instagram, Twitter, Twitch, and YouTube, all at CJ West _ CJ West and two underscores. I stream inconsistently on Twitch. I used to be regular. Sometimes I go pretty regular and I start streaming like twice a week for about a month, and then I just stop for a few months. I haven't streamed in like 3 months now, but there's always the chance that I will. You can check out my Instagram and TikTok. I post reels and stuff regularly there, so that's where you're going to get most of the contents coming out of me. And then I have a Facebook page where you can see upcoming events that I'll share everything that I'm coming up on, and the same with Twitter as well. The Twitter and Facebook are pretty active, but I'm mainly active on Instagram and TikTok, so check me out there.
Perfect. Well, again, thank you very much for taking time to speak to us. I'm so glad people bombarded me every time that I put up who do want to get on the podcast, and I'm so glad that people kept suggesting CJ West.
Thank you for having me on. So. And thank you to the people for thinking on me.
Yeah, thank you for your time.
No worries, mate. Thank you.